Good morning to you. Thank you for joining us for another episode of Off the Press. We bring you up to speed on all the latest headlines so you can go make sense of it. My name is Felicity Ezewike, and I don't do this alone. I have a guest, Ekene Ezeji, social commentator. Pleasure to have you join us.
Thank you for having me.
All right. We have the Punch newspaper first. The screamer here is minimum wage. Labour governors talk tough. Fresh crisis over negotiations. We have two riders to that story. Prepare for strike, NLC tells state councils. Government can't pay what it doesn't have. This is according to Fiani. We have the flood situation on the front page. That's not news to anyone. And this looks to be Ogun State, actually, and somewhere in Lagos as well, in Lekki. We also have underneath that not so pleasant flooded situation due to the rains. We have APC State Chairman SGF meet on face-off with Oshomole. Robbers behead policeman, guard in fuel station. And just beneath it, you also have another death, three killed as SARS cultists raid Lagos community. Samuel declares emergency on roads, engages beggar, high-tech. And then at the top of the paper, just above the head, masthead, you will see bank online transactions hit 49.4 trillion naira. Check payment shrink. You find the details on page 41. And the wife of the president is back. And today she's captured as saying, I went back to UK on doctor's advice. Downpour, gas man drowns, Lekki Ikorodu residents, landlords flee. I lost two cars to Saturday flooding. That's the landlord in Lagos speaking. Residents say flood exposes Lagos Ogun infrastructural deficit. And on the back page, you will see the still on the issue of the $9.6 billion. The caption for this one is re the $9.6 billion PNID award matters arising. Ekene, which of these just jumps out to you that you want to talk on first?
Well, I would have talked on the president's wife, but I know that all the other newspapers have her photo on the front page, so we'll save it for later. Okay. So we'll talk about the Labour, the NLC sort of preparing for a strike, and apparently the date of the strike should be this Wednesday, but I hear that they've arranged for a meeting on Tuesday.
Yeah, I think that meeting was scheduled.
Yeah. But at least before the strike day. Yeah. So we're hoping they'll reach some agreement. It's a little concerning when you hear statements like we can't pay what we don't have. You would ask the question, so when you were negotiating, what were you negotiating based on? And especially in the light of the fact, and I know we can't say this enough because as far as I'm concerned, it should be a headline every single day. You can't be asking people to manage when you are not cutting back on your own expenditures. You need to lead by example. So when we see you still pushing for cars to the tune of 5.5 billion, when we see you still driving with an entourage, a motorcade, when we see you still trying to claim pensions, these all send out the signal that there's money for you, but there isn't money for us. So I feel, well, let's watch and see what happens on Tuesday. But pending that, we should all really get behind the Labour Congress because they're fighting for our rights, really, and we shouldn't let...
The effect of a strike in this country at this moment, what do you think will be the ripple effect? Because in the long term, we're trying to ensure the economy is working so that the government can actually get the funds that they need to pay. So if we go on strike, we stall the economy, we stall every other thing that's going on. And then what happens?
You could see it from that point of view. But another perspective would be to say, how else will you get this government to recognize that they need to do the right thing by us? It seems to be the only weapon in our arsenal. So we need to do it and do it effectively. Nobody gains, in a sense, when you go on strike. But hopefully you will drive the message home in such a way as you remind them that actually you're there to serve our interests and not just your own.
Fair enough. The downpour situation.
Yes, I mean, who missed? It's really unusual in October to have a day of continuous, I think it started in the evening, on Friday evening, and rained all the way throughout Saturday. I know a friend whose wedding was scheduled for that day. I know the headache my friends had to go, I couldn't go, unfortunately, had to go through 8 hours just to get to a destination within Lagos. So, and I know some people who were stuck in an estate in VGC. They couldn't get out because of the flooding. I know even the road near where I live, the water was up to a lady's thighs. I felt as if I should be giving people lifts because you couldn't really understand how people would manage to get by on foot. There's no drainage as usual. So you can see why the water is being stocked up in these places. So yes, it's right that we need to continue to talk about infrastructure being put in place. Maybe I'll transition from this into or segue into someone will lose movement against traffic and against, you know, to put road infrastructure in place. I want to get behind him on this. I want to see a governor who has a mission and a vision and goes about it like somebody with some determination. So we saw that he was confiscating motorcycles that were riding the wrong way. We see him setting out to say we're going to renovate or rejuvenate some of these roads. We don't want to ask the dreaded question, which is where is he getting the money from? Because we know that Lagos, even though it was one of the high producing states, was also one of the most indebted when he came into authority. So,
well, there's a budget that hasn't been expended completely, isn't it?
Yeah, there's a budget for the roads, clearly.
So I guess he'll
come from there.
Okay,
but I mean, he seems very, it still looks like an ambitious project, but we're happy at least he has ambitions to put things in place. Hopefully, his works include drainage and, you know, proper infrastructure that will now curtail the flooding.
But generally, in this country, I don't think we're paying enough attention to the climate change issue. What do you think we can do, like, as a people to aside from talking about it, to approach the government to get to work on actually putting strategic long-term plans in place to address this climate change issue?
I think first on the list has to be sensitization. A lot of us are not even educated as to the connection between the way we treat our environment and the things we're experiencing now. So I think you have to start from, the people have to be on your side, let's put it that way, so that naturally they will recycle their products, they won't be wasteful. And before you now start talking about government doing something more, you know, something on a bigger scale, I think the individuals need to see their part in this and see the connection between what they're doing and actually making their environment a better place.
Yeah, I'm trying to see if this Oshomole's story is repeated somewhere else before we take it on. It's repeated somewhere else,
several,
right?
Several of the newspapers.
Okay. Okay. Let's look at some other papers now. This day has a couple of stories. We have CBN's support to power sector to hit 1.695 trillion naira. And then we have Aisha. I was in UK for medical attention, but I'm well now. I mean, we're thankful she's back. The screamer actually is governors to demand state share of federation account in dollars. It has a rider. Fayemi restates opposition to NFIU's directive to banks on joint accounts. We also have ASU crisis deepens as splinter group insists on registration. On the back page, before we go there is something just underneath the rider. We have military plots new strategy to end insurgency in 3 months. Mole's massive deployment of attack helicopters. Before I flip, do you see that happening? Because we've been on this for over 10 years.
Oh gosh, you make it sound like it's some sort of historical. What I read about this particular story was that they had employed something called Operation Camp, something camp, I think large camp or something, where they basically would designate groups of soldiers to just encamp in an area in a concentrated way and then strike attacks from there. People are saying that, well, which you'd say this isn't rocket science. If you're there in one place, then you're neglecting all the other places. So now they're now reviewing it based on that assessment, which you could say your five-year-old niece or nephew could tell you, and now they're going to a different approach. So we're not against the fact that they're reviewing, they're listening. I just wonder, really, though, at the level of consultation.
What is the need to have these, you know, reassuring words that repeatedly turns out
not to be
reassuring in the long term?
It's almost like they can't win, because if they didn't keep us informed, I would be one of the people pushing and saying, keep us, carry us along, because we need to build confidence.
Well.
But
that's
then,
something.
Like you say, the other side of it is when you now make promises that don't pan out, then it looks like you're just spewing empty words. So I wish they would say, you know, the more effective, you say, combination is, we'll do this, even if it's something very minimal, and you actually do it, then your word carries power, but not when you're saying things that you're not achieving. 3 months. I mean, this is by the new year we should be expecting.
Well, let's see what happens in 3 months.
Exactly. We'll be here.
We will still be here, God willing. All right, Alex Oti, we have outside the box. Your revenue is not too low. Your costs are too high. Whatever that means, you need to go read it to really understand what it's about. There's a picture of Zainab Ahmed. I guess she's on the microscope this morning. I guess that's it for the
newspaper. I know it will feature again, but let me just talk on it. The local government and the state government. Apparently, some people had said that we have three tiers of governance and included the local government and the state. When they met, the NFU, they said no, that actually we only have two tiers. That's the federal and the state, and that they don't know all this interference in trying to get the state government to have their own accounts unsupervised. And, you know, they're basically resisting the autonomy that
of local government.
Most people see as a positive thing, because there's really no benefit to having a government system that's nearer to the people, and yet they're hamstrung by the state government, who are still puppeteering them and still taking the money from them. And
so, where will the power of the state governors be if they don't have control over the local government? So I think it's a battle of supremacy.
Well, I guess it's one of these things that I feel should be a healthy check, because the state government should really check the local government. I mean, should check the states. The local government should be check the state government. So they should be able to act to some degree autonomously. They shouldn't be like errand boys. We want to be able to feel that at some level these people are accountable to us and not to their godfathers, you know, which is what they're maintaining so far.
All right, which do we go with? Let's see the Vanguard now. Minimum wage again is on the front page. This time it's captioned this way: governors dare labor over strike. That's it on your screen. It has three riders. Say it will be exercise in futility. Add, we can't promise what we don't have as labor intensifies mobilization for strike. At the top, just above the masthead, you will see the blue part. You will see investors anticipate further decline in TB rates as CBN sells 122 billion naira. The government's stealing public funds need deliverance, says Nasrallah government.
You're laughing. I laugh to beat myself, actually.
I'm just seeing it, so I beg your pardon. Is that governors stealing public funds need deliverance, says Nasrallah government. Okay. Edo 2020, Oshomole's House, Obaseki chief of staff attacked. Passenger dies at Lagos airport after receiving news of wife's death. I saw that story in passing yesterday. That was really sad to read. How police averted bloody traffic robbery operation in Lagos, arrest gang leader. Armed robbers behead police sergeant. We've taken that story. Presidency APC battle PDP over ineffective opposition. We don't have certificate fudges as members, PDP replies. Okay, on the back is the usual sports, but let's see. There's Oshomole's House, Obaseki, chief of staff. Now, today, the news, I think this maybe this story didn't run in the news, but this morning, there is an update that the state government said they're not aware of the alleged attack, whereas the aide to the national chairman of APC saying his home was attacked. And now the Vanguard is saying it's all in a push for 2020. Is Oshomole running for governor again?
No, not that we're aware of, but I think he's still pushing for influence in Edo State, despite all his proclamations that he's not trying to get involved. But this is just a reminder, in case we forgot, but I don't think we're likely to, that politics is still largely a thug affair. And what they don't seem to see, I don't know, we're very short-sighted at politicians, because they're in a way initiating thugs to do their errands. And by doing that, I'm assuming a lot when I make this statement, because it hasn't been proven, it's alleged. But let's just say that these people who went to attack, let's say the alleged attack took place by these thugs, they didn't send themselves, you know. So clearly they've taken sides. And if they're doing it in the name of these people who are busy fighting themselves, they say when two elephants fight, the grass suffers. These thugs, when they finish, they'll be looking for, they will become the next kingpins. And then you'll now claim you have nothing to do with them. But you're creating this demon, this Frankenstein, so to speak. You know, don't you look ahead and see that this is a problem for all of us? So is this thirst or lust for power more important than the prosperity of our nation? I'm not really sure. And that takes me to the Nasarawa state government. You know, why is he saying, I hope he's not part of people that need deliverance? Because here we are, we're looking around us and we're yet to see people who are focused on getting the job done. For me, it's an embarrassment that we're looking towards an election. And the things that are, you know, in a way making headlines are thug activities. We're not looking at people declaring what they'll do for us,
Our government seem to use this God factor, religious factor as a blinder sometimes for the things that they do?
That's an interesting one. So are you implying that somehow calling it deliverance makes
it... Yeah, because public, you're doing it consciously.
Okay. I see where you're going. And now it's like saying, the devil made me do it.
Yes.
Well, you know, again, they're playing to the people they know will buy that kind of thing, because we are a bit religious sometimes. And
so not a bit, we're a lot religious.
I think they need more than deliverance, but that's a start. They need to be taken out of power. If you're there to steal, you're a thief, you need to be incarcerated. And let's get people who are actually there to do the job. Then whilst you're incarcerated, we can deal with your rehabilitation and deliverance.
All right, we have the Nation newspaper. Bielsa is on the front. Bielsa and Kogi 2019. A couple of writers there. PDP will win in Bayelsa without defectors. We also have only Bello can defeat Bello. APC boasts. Ebebi, others join APC. PDP petitions IG over a talk. You find more page 10 off the paper. Obaseki behind siege to my home, says Oshomole. Governor, please deny attack as APC Omoagege seek probe. There are a couple of quotes there for you. Work begins on Lagos roads. Sanwo-Olu declares emergency. And of course, the woman of the moment, that's how the nation is captioning it, Aisha Buhari. She's back and smiley and looking all healthy. At the top of the paper, we have prepare for strike. NLC tells workers, Ngige, they know the rules. Fiemi, NFIU can't dictate to governors. And a bit of sports for you. Eagle star Aribo gets plaudits. Nigeria holds Brazil. On the back, the usual are there. Comment and debate. Today's three acts. What is the three acts? Go read. And then hardball, belaboring on walkable tricks. That's the thought shared today. But let's look at...
It's time for Aisha Buhari. And you can't, well, for me anyway, you can't but like her in the sense that she's not predictable. She's someone who... there's something a bit refreshing about the way she speaks to the press, and she's open. She's already, from just arriving at the airport, she was very open to speak to the press. And she's clearly not someone you can intimidate very easily. We missed her, in a sense, when she was away. But having said all that, she typifies the privilege and abuse of power, because she's saying things like, oh, I go away every year for a holiday. I go to Spain. I spent a couple of months in Spain. I don't neglect my motherly duties. Oh, I went from Saudi Arabia, and when I was told I needed my health attending to, I went to the UK to have my health attended to. We know her children's school abroad, two of them, I think, University of Surrey. She now has a daughter. She can go to Spain to do what we call a mugwa for, you know, because she had a baby. She's living a good life, and she's the first lady of a country that is called the poverty capital of the world. So I don't know how she manages to do all this and still smile, and then you have people welcoming her like she's the empress herself. When I watched the interview, there was a lady there dancing her life away because my mama don't come, kind of, you know. And I looked at this whole thing, I thought, this is a joke. I like this lady, and I'm glad she's back. And even when they asked her questions about the so-called alleged marriage, second wife, she said, it's not me you should ask. Ask the people who are being, like, you know. So she has a way of responding to the press that tells you that she's not at all intimidated or afraid to speak her mind. You know, so you already have BBC Hausa waiting for her to gather the freshest news off the press. And we will, I'm sure we'll be hearing a lot from her in the days to come.
Yeah, but I'm tempted to ask a couple of questions, but I'll just reserve that.
Really?
Yes. Please ask. Okay, let's look at the Bayelsa and Kogi 2019. It's just actually weeks away now.
Yes, yes. Like I said, again, to do with the Edo State, Bayelsa and Kogi, I wish we had more cerebral issues to discuss.
Unfortunately, for Kogi and Bayelsa.
Yeah, I wish we were discussing manifestos. I wish we were discussing, you know, programs for the state. I wish we were looking ahead and saying, what new strategy are we going to put in place to get us out of this economic quagmire we are in as a nation? What, you know, groundbreaking approach do you have? I wish we were talking about such things. Then I would be engaged in this politics. But rather, we're talking about kingpins and thugs and, you know, godfathers. I'm really, I find it's old news, I'm sorry to say. You know, we're looking forward to a fresh approach to politics that looks like they actually intend to serve the people and to make a difference.
Okay, let's see what's on the back page. A lot, actually, on the back page. A lot of segments in between. You might want to go take a look at it. So let's quickly see what's on the front page of sports. That's Complete Sports newspaper this morning. Brazil won, Nigeria won. Outstanding Aribo seems to be the man of the moment. It's also captured on the Nation newspaper. The Complete Sports is putting it, outstanding Aribo with exclamation marks, scores again as Eagles hold Brazil in Singapore. Uzoho, I will be back stronger and better. Barcelona prefers signing Rashford to Firmino. Okay. We also have Barcelona I Lautaro release clause. There's something else here. Okay. Aribo delighted to score again. He seems to be the man of the moment. Still on the front page. You have Ndidi reveals in Eagles draw. Neymar to be offered PSG contract extension. And then Real Madrid prepared to sell Luka Modric. On the back page is the usual transfer story there for you. I don't know if you have any thoughts on any of this.
I do. I mean, I love the world of sports. I'm a tennis. That's part of the world of sports. But I love the ethos of sports.
Yeah.
You can see the reward already following on the heels of the effort made. So you can see Aribo saying, you know, you can see the glory that's following his performance. And when Zohair, I think, he said, I'll be back, you better believe it, because there's that competition, there's that merit-based system that rewards you instantly for the efforts put in. When I look at, for example, and I have to go into tennis at this game, Coco Gauff, this 15-year-old who won her first major championship, you can see that this is a girl who was motivated because she could see that there was something she could attain too. And so I wish our nation was built around those principles. People are ready to exert themselves legitimately if you just put a goal in front of them that is achievable and you reward them for that. So that's why I love the world of sports. You know, money is flowing through it.
Yes, and you work and you get the gain immediately. You don't have to wait.
Yeah, nobody is going to deny you what you've rightly earned.
Or try and reduce the percentage of your salary.
I mean, sometimes they don't pay them.
Everything is agreed beforehand.
Yeah.
That's the I wish I was a sportswoman.
Oh, no, it's not too late for us.
No, it is late.
No, never say never.
Thank you very much for coming on the program this morning.
Pleasure,
always a pleasure to have you join us. And of course to you, thank you very much for sharing your time with us on TV this morning. We hope it was rewarding for you. You got to know what is on the headlines and then go make your choice. We hope to see you again tomorrow. Take care of yourself and have a rewarding day ahead.